Hey, welcome, 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 welcome again to the video. Here we're going to speak up in spite of tremendous pressure not to say anything these days, right? We're supposed to be just good little lemmings. Take our punishment, take our medicine. We're not taking our medicine here. We're dishing it out. You know what? The world is at our mercy. This is a fact. The world is on its knees begging for mercy in front of us. We must state this as an assertion. And good thing, we have mercy. We have mercy. We are merciful. But truly, the world is at our mercy. We're not at the mercy of the world at all. The world is completely at our mercy, 100% at our mercy. And it's begging, please, please don't get rid of me. Please don't get rid of me. We say, okay, look, I'll be merciful. Instead of, but I will see you in a different purpose. I'll give a different purpose to you, which is the purpose of non-imperilment, non-vulnerability, non-imperilment. I'll give that purpose to you, but I will keep you around world, at least the basic format, somewhat of that format, for a while. And the world says, thank you so much, that's really wonderful, I knew you would do that for me. So we are merciful, but the world is absolutely at our mercy. I was thinking about, this came to me, how did this come to me? I was thinking about Tiger Woods. He just had this interview, and he says basically he's finished. He can't physically function anymore, which is quite extraordinary. Three back surgeries, and I was wondering, who's the best golfer of all time? The answer is Tiger Woods is. I've seen Arnold Palmer, I've seen Jack Nicklaus, I've seen Tiger Woods. Tiger Woods is the only golfer I've ever seen where you got the feeling that the golf course was at his mercy. You know, he had the golf course at his mercy. The golf course was begging for mercy. So, you know, never was the golf course putting him in a position of peril. It was always the other way around. I mean, this is like the dream golfer. I mean, right, really? I mean, every time we go out, of course, please don't hurt me. I mean, I know you can devastate me, but take it easy on me. Tiger Woods is exactly opposite. He says, you know, I have this course absolutely at my mercy. I'll do whatever I want to with this golf course. And he did. He did. It's the only golfer I've ever seen like that, actually. Extraordinary golfer. And so I started thinking, hey, wait a minute, you know, this world, about this world is like a golf course. Are we at its mercy, or is it at our mercy? This is the question. And I was thinking about this attitude that Tiger Woods had. And he went on the golf course and he says, you got no chance, golf course. You got no chance. You know, I'm here and you have no chance. This is his attitude. And I said, wow, I wonder if we could have that attitude towards the world. Could we have this attitude towards the world? And I thought, yes, we can. Yes, we can. I say, world, you're completely at my mercy. 100% at my mercy. You can do absolutely nothing to me. You're the one who's at my mercy completely. Just think about that. Start saying it. Just like, wow. Wow, wow. So, you know, people can be helpful to one another. And I know a lot of people think Tiger Woods is always a terrible person. Well, people used to think he was a really great person. I had a little encounter with Tiger Woods. He signed my scorecard once, and I thought he was a pretty nice person, actually. And so I never really had such a bad feeling towards him. I said, you know, he slipped, he fell down, he's had trouble, but he's beneficial to the world. He showed us, hey, we don't have to live on our knees with this world. He's using a golf course as a metaphor. All right, we don't really have to. So I get something positive out of that. Just thinking, how can I turn this thing of him saying I can't do it anymore and the world has beat me? You know, I say, hey, wait a minute, it didn't used to be that way. I remember how, you know, you would come out on a golf course and just say, hey, again, golf course, you don't have a chance, and you know it. And you know it. I'm the authority here on this golf course. You're not the authority, golf course. I'm the authority, and I'm gonna show it to you. I'm gonna show, but I'll be merciful to you. I'll be nice. I'll be merciful. I won't rub it in too much. But you know, you don't have no chance. You have no chance, and you know it. It's like, wow, golf nirvana. So a lot of us thought, hey, maybe we can be that way too. And so we, you know, I got into golf more because of Tiger Woods. I remember that. I had Tiger Woods hat, Tiger Woods shoes, Tiger Woods clothing, Tiger Woods golf ball. I mean, just everything. And we wanted to think, you know, maybe we can go out there and say, golf course, you know, you're at my mercy. Well, it hasn't quite worked out that way yet. With the new swing I got, it may be going that way. I'm telling you, I'm gonna try. I said, golf course, you're at my mercy. So, but we can say, world, you're at my mercy. You're totally at my mercy because I could make you vanish like that, which is true. We could all absolutely just decide we don't want perception anymore. And the whole notion of this ridiculous notion of time, space, process, and form, we'd realize it's never been. It's never been. But the world says, world, please have some mercy. Don't go quite so fast. What is this? This is continuity fear. This is our continuity fear. The world is reflecting continuity fear back to us, saying, please, you know, take it easy on me. Don't make me disappear. And we say, okay, world, you got a deal. That's fine. I will see you in the death-free realm state, in the non-compounded state, in the vision of oneness state, in the non-imperilment state. I will see all of this as reflecting non-imperilment back to me, perfect non-imperilment. But I will still be experiencing a reflection, as it were, okay? So we're not directly experiencing still. We're still experiencing a reflection, which is perception. It's a belief that there's a reflection happening. But it's a reflection of non-imperilment. So we are in charge of the world 100%. The world is totally at our mercy. Say, the world is at my mercy. The world is absolutely at my mercy. Every last speck of this world and this universe is totally at my mercy. This is a fact. It's true. It's absolutely true. Because there is actually no world other than our belief in perception. Because there is no compoundment taking place. Reality cannot be compounded. I am the non-compoundable now. I am the non-compoundable now, the one and only sole authority that there is. And the world, the belief in a world is totally at my mercy because it's only a belief. It is only a belief, actually. The belief that crystallization of pure spaciousness can happen. It cannot. This is mere appearance. It is mere appearance. Nothing other than that. But we will decide to keep perception for a little while longer. We'll have mercy upon the world and say, world, this is how you're going to, this is the purpose you're going to serve for me now. You're going to reflect non-imperilment to me. And this is how it is. So put your health in the hands of the Holy Spirit. Take your health care out of the hands of the world and put it in the hands of the Holy Spirit. I saw a card today. It said, keep Christ in Christmas. And I went into the store. He's the only person in the store. I said, is that your car out there? He said, yeah. I said, well, thank you for having this Keep Christ in Christmas. I really appreciate it. And we got into a very nice sharing of ideas. And it turns out he's very aware. He was very aware of what's going on in the world. He's a very elderly person. He understood. He's aware of the media, the banks, you know, everything that's going on, what's happening. Wise person. It was very nice to have that reinforcement. So I spoke up. Usually I never speak up, really. But because I knew maybe it must be him. I don't want to embarrass anybody. But I said, he's the only customer. It must be his car. It was. So this is like a mutual, you rarely hear this anymore, ever. You never, certainly don't hear a Merry Christmas. May Christ bless your new year. What is Christmas really about? As I said, we have something. Jesus said, you have something you have to attend to. Very important issue you must attend to. But you don't really understand what it is. So just have faith in me that I'm telling you there really is this a very important issue, which is our continuity fear, which keeps us believing that in form and believing in this dream of impairment, that we have a need to change what we are. We must attend to this. It is not true. It is simply not true. And so Jesus knew, he knows we have this continuity fear issue that we must evaporate. He knows that we must have mercy upon the world and have it reflect non-imperilment back to us. He knows that reality cannot be compounded. There's no such thing as compoundment. There's only the oneness. There's never the two-ness. Two-ness doesn't exist. He knows all of this. He knows we have a very important issue we need to attend to, but we don't know it. We know there's something doesn't feel right, but Jesus says, look, you have to look at what doesn't feel right and find out where is it coming from. And he said, you must do this, you must prepare, you must work at it, you must work at it. This is Jesus' message, is it? You must work at this, you must attend to it. And he said, it's not easy, because you're not sure what it is. You have, so we set up this discipline, religious discipline of going to church and say, telling yourself every day, there's something really important I have to attend to. And if I don't, I'll forget about it and think that I don't have to do it. And this is very bad for us. This very causes great misery. He also knows that there's likely to be some imperilment issues coming upon the world. He said that there would be. Certainly, he talked about Jerusalem getting wiped out, which is an imperilment, was an imperilment issue back then for the Jews and the diaspora and etc. Basically, all the Jews were, you know, raised, the land was raised, and they were driven out, and killed, enslaved, driven out of, you know, the Holy Land. And, you know, for them, that was a pretty big imperilment situation, to say the least. But what he said is that there's going to be an imperilment situation upon the entire world. We're not, if it did, those days weren't cut short, no living, nothing living, there'd be nothing living left on the whole planet. This is what Jesus said. Now, maybe the writers back then, the apocryphal writers, maybe they exaggerated what he said. I don't know. There was a lot of apocryphal literature at the time, etc., talking about the end times. But if from my, the universe, the Holy Spirit, grace of God speaking to me in terms of foreshadowing and saying, hey, you know, this is what's coming. There's no question that it's foreshadowing some sort of space rocks coming in and hitting this world. It certainly seems that way. So Jesus said, look, if you don't prepare, you won't be ready. Like the foolish virgins, the ones that didn't prepare, they came in, the door was locked, it was too late. So we must attend to this all-important issue, which is what we're doing here. What we're doing here, we're looking and seeing, what is this issue? Well, today, I was very tired, and I sort of lay back in a seat. And I was kind of between sleep and waking. I sort of drifted into this, and I forgot about the world. But I was still semi-conscious, you might say. But thoughts of the world disappeared. They really disappeared. And I wasn't into dreaming either. And I felt this beautiful, peaceful perfection-like, just a smooth, everything is perfect feeling. And I wasn't aware of anything causing it. I was not aware of any causation. I was not aware of any narrative whatsoever that was giving rise to this. It just was there on its own, as it is. And from that, then I began to say, hey, wait a minute, that the feeling of perfection is not based due to some narrative. Not any narrative whatsoever. It's not based, it is not derivative, it is not an effect of some causation. It is the primary base feeling, that is. The feeling of spaciousness, pure spaciousness, the feeling of reality is this flawless, effortless feeling of perfection, which in Longchenpa's book, Spaciousness, in the last chapter we read, I don't know what chapter that was. Was it chapter 2 or chapter 1 was spacious, chapter 2 was Buddha feels, chapter 3, simile for the luminous mind. So, yeah. I think it was chapter 2. I don't know. Anyway. Maybe it was chapter 2. And this is what he's saying about the nature. He reinforced this over and over and over and over and over and over again. You cannot compound pure spaciousness. It's not this, it's not that. This is what I got. I experienced this, that this feeling of perfection is just there. Not based on any narrative, not based on any causation, not, you know, not because something's been sublimated or reified or altered or fixed or uncompounded or whatever. No. This is the basic feeling of reality. The feeling of isness. So this is very, 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 very profound. That perfection is not derived from any narrative whatsoever. Feeling perfect is not derived from any narrative at all. Wow. It's just all this belief in not feeling perfect is derived from narrative. But feeling perfect is not derived from any narrative whatsoever. So this has been some of my day. It's been more than that too. A A lot of very, very wonderful, amazing stuff is happening. And more reinforcement of potential asteroid problem continues. I can't seem to avoid it. I ran into somebody that drew my attention to this issue, re-emphasized it about, I don't know, 6 months ago or something. I met him again. And I said, how's your day? How's your life going? He says, I was driving on the freeway and there's this terrible road obstacle, some big block of asphalt, and I hit it and ruined my front wheel of my motorcycle and dented it, and I tried to get it fixed. Nobody can fix it. I tried to order a new one. They sent me a wrong one. You know, I'm having a terrible problem. I don't have any transportation, nothing. And then we started talking. Well, is this foreshadowing personal or is it global? And I told him, in my life, it's turned out to be global. That I learned a lesson that when you focus on helping everyone out, is that the what arises for you generally, very important dreams, have to do with global situations, universal global situations. And I was just thinking, wow. I wonder if the hitting that obstacle, that chunk of rock, asphalt chunk, a black, you know, high albedo, which a space rock could have this very dark aspect to it. The Earth hitting the rim of his motorcycle, putting this dent in it like a crater, and it can't be fixed. It's a big problem. In other words, I wonder if that wasn't foreshadowing an asteroid hitting the planet, because he actually feels that this could very well happen. He's a very intelligent person, actually. So I keep bumping into these people who feel it is going to happen. And they turn out to be very intelligent people. And so, you know, the universe is speaking to them. The grace of God is speaking to us right now and saying there could very well be some sort of imperilment as this purpose of this whole ridiculous whim is imperilment. Now, I also realize that people here with the defensiveness of continuity fear fears reason. Greatly fears reason, because reason, it feels reason is capable of pointing out that this, all of this just rests on whim, which is nothing. Okay, nothing at all. This belief in trying to change up what you are is based on a whim, not on a need. And reason is capable of seeing this, or of revealing it to us, showing us, this is the truth, look at this. So, continuity fear hates reason. It tries to foster emotionalism in the world. Or mechanical logicness, you know, scientific logicness, sort of thing, not genuine reason at all. It is very, very intimidated and frightened by genuine reason. And so there's all these people that are reacting out of emotion, and they're very illogical. They don't really, and continuity fear loves this. Oh yeah, this is great. We've got to have more of that in the world. Let's all become very irrational and emotional, and stay away from reason. Very few people, I don't know, have I met that are into reason. There are some here watching the video, and you know what how different you seem to those who are just into this emotionalism, reactionalism. Reason is capable of seeing this is all based on a whim, not a need. Absolutely is. It is capable of seeing that perfection, the feeling of perfection, is not based on any narrative whatsoever. It is capable of revealing all of this. It's capable of revealing everything we need to see. And there's this massive bias against reason in the world. It's just extraordinary. As my Christian friend I talked to, what they said, the media is just terrible. And then he said, you know, today, another shooting. I told him right away, I said, look, I don't pay any attention to the news. So I don't care what happens, doesn't make any difference to me. I don't need to, you know, evaluate different forms of nothing, actually, right? Different forms of nothing. None of these narratives are necessary for perfection. So why follow any of these narratives? None of them are necessary to feel perfect. None of them are necessary. There's no narrative that is necessary to feel perfect, unless you say, well, it's the narrative of pointing this out, which is certainly helpful. It's not necessary, but it's helpful. You might say it's helpful, but not necessary. Because whether this pointed out or not, the feeling of perfection still is there, and it's not based on any narrative whatsoever. But we believing that what we are has to be derived from some narrative, we overlook the natural state, the natural feeling of perfection. We overlook it entirely. So it's helpful for those who are aware of this to point it out. It's very helpful. So I remember, what was it, a year ago, year and a half? I don't know how long ago, but it was quite some time ago. And I said, you know, we've got to start cutting back on following the news. I said, follow this channel here. It's better for you than following the news. And I said, I guarantee you that there are going to be like shootings almost every single day, either some bombings or shootings, something like that. Every day is going to get worse and worse and worse and worse and worse. And apparently it has. I, you know, just through the faint nooks and cracks, I try to keep it all out. You might hear someone say, like he did say, oh, did you hear there's a shooting? I said, immediately, still, yeah. I said, whatever. Doesn't matter. I'm not following that narrative. I don't follow any news narrative anymore at all. But apparently, there's just been incredible drumbeat of shootings. Maybe all of them entering candidates, I don't know. But trying to get gun control. But in around the world, just these, you know, terrible acts taking place. I haven't been following any of them. I'm not following any of those narratives. I'm not following any narrative of this world, really, hardly at all. Well, I'm following the Golden State Warriors a little bit as they start season 20-0. The team that was the worst franchise in sports history for 18 years, the laughingstock of all the sports, we suffered hideously through that. And now they can't lose. They cannot lose. And so we're sitting here saying, are you kidding me? What? It's, you know, so, oh well. Oh well. Was it worth the 18 years of hell? No, it wasn't. It absolutely was not. So I just say, okay, it's just, it's weird. It's weird what's happened, really. But I try not to follow anything too closely in the world, any narrative at all. It's not necessary. What's important is the narrative of realizing, practicing that perfection is not based on any narrative whatsoever. Perfection is not based on any narrative whatsoever. No narrative whatsoever. Not a good narrative, not a bad narrative, not a triumphal narrative, not a tragic narrative. No narrative at all is involved in the natural state. None. There's no compoundment. Compoundment meaning two things put together. There are no two things. Therefore, there's no thingness at all, really. To say there's thingness is meaningless. What could you apply it to? Nothing. There's only one thing. What could you apply the meaning to, really? It just is. Reality just is. It's the oneness. Not the two-ness, the oneness. There's just the oneness. That's it. But we can have that fact reflected to us, back to us, at least the non-imperilment, the perfect non-imperilment. It is very helpful to us because our creativity, we've been using it to give this dream of imperilment. And so we think that we need to experience this and that the light will continue to give us this experience. The mind, the light, it has some need to give us this experience. And this is the way it functions, and we can't get free of it. And if we tried to get free of it, we wouldn't have any experience at all, because somehow we think the light God has caused the light to only give this dream of imperilment. This is absolutely not true. Absolutely not true. The light is still perfectly free. It just does what we ask it to do. We said, give us a dream of imperilment. That's what it does. We said, give us a dream of non-imperilment. That's what it will do. If we truly want this, I can say it, give it lip service, but I have to really be willing to accept it in order to actually experience it. So this is better than the news, right? And someone said nothing worse than the local news, which is true. I wandered into a room and the television's on and the local news is just horrible. I said, yeah, God. I mean, what kind of habits lead us to spend our time listening to that stuff? And what kind of people are there who bring us all this? You know, it just severe continuity fear addicts, to say the least. So I just boycotting the news, boycotting Christmas, and having mercy on the world. The world's completely at my mercy. See, the world is absolutely completely at my mercy with no exceptions whatsoever. It's totally at my mercy. But the good news is I'm merciful. Is he right? I'm inherently merciful. That is true. I'm inherently merciful. So, we're spending time here with what really matters. We're attending to the business that Jesus told us we need to attend to. And he said when he returned, he'd know the ones that have attended to his business, their business that he told us, and the ones who did not. Not that the ones who did not are going to be thrown into some eternal lake of eternal damnation or something. No, I mean, they will continue on with the impairment training that they're putting themselves through, hoping that will enable them to gain some sort of new will to change what they are, which will never happen. So yesterday, I had a terrible day because I didn't sleep the night before. It was awful. Last night, I slept well. Today, I got up. It's not so cold. My whole attitude flipped into a very positive attitude. Oh, I know what it was. I've been eating all this food, snacking, eating corn chips and pizza and all these mixed nuts I thought, I'm stuffing myself. I'm overeating. This is terrible. So I haven't been weighing myself on the scale, but this morning I said, oh man, okay, I'll take the medicine. I'm sure I'm just going to go into depression now because it's going to be real high. I got on the scale and I lost a pound. I mean, it's like, what? He said, this is fantastic. As soon as I saw it, I said, oh my gosh. Things aren't quite as bad as I thought they were. And my whole mood suddenly shifted into something very positive and said, you know what? I can go for it now. I didn't slide back into bad habits. I thought I'd really backslid into bad habits. And I had been backsliding into a couple of them. But I said, you know what? Let's go full blast and keep our good habits going right now. We're not defeated. And that's the last thing I told that Christian man. I said, you know what? Just keep in mind, we are not defeated. Nobody can defeat us. That's what I told him. No one can defeat us. He says, you're right. Nobody. No one can defeat us. Okay, the world is at our mercy. The world is at our mercy entirely. This is true for everyone. The world is at our mercy, my mercy entirely. I don't need to see a world of impairment. It's up to each one of us. I mean, we can either see a world of impairment or one of non-impairment. Because really, all the perception that's taking place is in our own mind, right? It's not really out there that perception's happening. It's in the brain. It's brain, but even more so, what is the brain but a mental projection itself? So all this perception is just happening within the mind entirely. And it can change its purpose and see, instead of a dream of impairment, a dream of non-impairment. Turn our health care over to the Holy Spirit. Say, Holy Spirit, my health is now in your hands. It's not in the hands of the world anymore. It's in your hands. Holy Spirit, my livelihood is not in the hands of the world anymore. It's in your hands. My livelihood, my health, my destiny, Holy Spirit, is not in the hands of this world anymore. It's in your hands, Holy Spirit. Give your life over to the Holy Spirit. Every aspect of it. Practice that. And you will find your circumstances, what getting better, positivity. I spoke of some bad news that I was aware of, some really bad news, and well, the news has suddenly shifted, and what was supposed to be some very, very, very bad news now vanished. At least the bad news part of it. We're not sure what else there is, what's going on exactly, except what they thought was there. No trace, which is exactly, I told the Holy Spirit, just make it disappear. No trace whatsoever. We're the sole authority here. Fear has no authority whatsoever. The world is completely at our mercy. All sickness is completely at my mercy. Say that. All sickness is completely at my mercy. Totally at my mercy. And I'll say, well, you know, sickness, now you're going to reflect health. Okay, I'll keep the format, potentiality of your reflection, the mirror there, but you're going to be reflecting like immaculate health now instead of illness, sickness. This is within our power. It's entirely within our power. We're imagining this whole world, existence, the universe, the way we think it is, time, space, process, and form. We're imagining all that. It's an hallucination. It's a belief system, actually. So it's totally at our mercy, completely. Just like a hallucination is at our mercy, right? If we're hallucinating, say, hey, wait a minute. This hallucination is at my mercy. I'm not at the mercy of the hallucination. It's the hallucination that's at the mercy of me. I'm the one who's producing it. It's not producing itself. Not at all. It's not some objectified something that's producing itself. It is entirely subjective, and since there's only subjectivity, there's not even subjectivity, because that's a dualistic notion of subject-object. There just isness. It just is. It just is. Now, I'm trying to get a lot in here because I don't want the cold, whatever cold there is, to sink in too much. I'm getting more quick here because outside it's that's not too bad right now. It's supposed to rain here tomorrow, and that'll make it damp and chilly. And then once the front moves out, then the cold air will come in, and just let it keep raining for a while. Keep the clouds around. That's why the desert gets cold at night. No moisture in the air, no clouds. The heat just straight up in the atmosphere. Gone. So keep the clouds around here. And maybe they will. We're into December now. So what is December for? Well, have to look at it. Not sure. So can we get a boost here from our friend Longchenpa, our honorary Christian friend Longchenpa, as we are honorary Dzogchen friends, both compatible, both reinforcing each other, pointing out the fundamental truth that nothing can be compounded. Reality cannot be compounded, and since reality cannot be compounded, there's nothing other than reality. So nothing at all can be compounded, Jesus says. Nothing real can be threatened, and nothing unreal exists. Nothing real can be threatened, nothing unreal exists. Nothing real can be compounded, and since that's a fact, nothing unreal exists at all. There's no such thing as compoundment. Existing. It doesn't exist. We're just imagining it on a foolish whim that there's some, that compoundment has happened, that materiality has happened. It hasn't happened. It will never happen. There's no such thing as materiality. That this is all spirituality, 100%. There's only spirituality. There's no materiality at all. We don't have to get rid of materiality. We just have to recognize that there isn't any. There never has been any materiality. I had to put someone on block the comments, not block from viewing videos, but they're being very diversionary and divisive, very bad in terms of just trying to divert us from what we're focusing on, and trying to say it's all much ado about nothing. There's nothing here to watch. You know, this is terrible, and et cetera. I said, I'm not going to put up with that anymore. We don't have time to put up with that. I'm going to stand up for the viewers here, because in saying there's nothing here to see, this is just, you know, the stupidest thing ever. Forget, don't watch it. This is terrible, blah, 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 blah. You know, he's insulting all the viewers here, too, saying they're idiots, too. He calls me an idiot. He's calling the viewers idiots, too. So I'm not going to put up with that anymore. I like to be super tolerant, but I found out that there's some who simply, they just want us to fail. That's all they want. As if everybody fails, that's somehow some ultimate success. That's magical thinking, and we're not going to stand for that. There is value here. We are pointing out the truth, and that's super valuable. Now, whether we're doing it in a way that some people like or not, well, guess what? It's hard work, and not everybody may have some super great charisma, but you don't have to do the work. You don't have to. Perfection doesn't need a narrative to be perfect. The feeling of perfection doesn't need any narrative at all. It doesn't need a charismatic narrative whatsoever. None whatsoever. So, however it's pointed out, it's all still all good, and it's not dependent on that narrative either. It's not dependent on my narrative. It's not dependent on anyone's narrative. Just God. And that's the only narrative that there is. That's the only narrative that counts. Chapter 3, the simile for luminous mind. Since luminous mind excludes nothing whatsoever, so all experience is of the nature of luminous mind. The simile for luminous mind is sky-like, because that mind has no cause and cannot be objectified. It has no location. It is ineffable and beyond ideation. So the spaciousness of the sky is an apt metaphor. If the metaphor denotes nothing specific, how can it evoke anything definite? understand that the sky is a metaphor for natural purity. What is evoked is the sky-like intrinsic presence of luminous mind, incapable of verbalization, defying illustration and description. Such is the vast matrix of intrinsic clarity, motionless, clear light. Uncontrived, spontaneity, without status or dimension, it is the Dharmakaya, the wide open center of the luminous heart. It is evinced by whatever arises as creativity. At its point of inception, without base or creator, what does arise, being mere label, vanishes into spaciousness when identified, assimilated into undifferentiated virginal sameness. Free of perceptual duality, it is the matrix of spaced-out smoothness. This zero-dimensional reality of self-sprung awareness in the now, revealed by analogy, well-defined similitude, evocation, and evidence, the very essence denoted by these three beautiful sky bolts, assimilates everything without differentiation or exclusion. It is the womb-like space of this vast expanse of equality. In the now, everything is always the same, without temporal or qualitative distinction. That is the vision of Samantabhadra Vajrasattva. Luminous mind is like the solar nucleus. Its nature is clear light, forever uncompounded. Nothing can veil its translucent spontaneity. And as unthought reality, elaborate variation is impossible. The Dharmakaya as emptiness, the Sambhogakaya as clarity, and the Nirmanakaya as radiance are the three kayas. Yet they can never be united or separated. And since in the now, their potential is wrought in spontaneity, darkening flaws and faults cannot veil them. They are identical in their changelessness and timelessness, identical in their saturation of Buddhas and sentient beings alike, identical as self-sprung luminous mind. The creativity of that luminous mind occurs as any darn thing, as thought or non-thought, as manifestation or potential, as diverse and various as living beings' perceptions. Things appear, but they never crystallize. Everything is like mirage, dream, echo, like apparition, reflection in water, and castles in the sky. Like hallucination, things are clearly apparent, but do not truly exist. Know all experience as rootless and baseless, mere adventitious appearance, just ephemeral occurrence, circumstantial and contingent. In the spontaneous nature of luminous mind, the display non-crystallizing, samsara and nirvana emanate magically, to be assimilated simultaneously into its spaciousness. Know that display does not stray from its original, natural perfection. Here and now, everything lies within the scope of luminous mind. Perfect in its oneness, perfect in its all-inclusiveness, everything perfect in its natural, uncontrived reality. As perfection, it is self-sprung awareness in the now. Since luminous mind is neither visible nor invisible, neither outer nor inner, samsara nor nirvana can exist concretely. Yet by virtue of its dynamic creativity, the myriad display, the material and spiritual dimensions, samsara and nirvana, shine out. Forms that at their very inception are essentially empty, unborn but appearing to be born, appear. Yet nothing whatsoever has been created. Nothing crystallizes, although it may appear to do so. And that non-crystallizing illusion is the form of emptiness. Even in its apparent stability, nothing really subsists. for groundless and changeless whatever appears. And however it appears, it can never be substantiated, and so it is labeled simply insubstantial. Since appearances appear by themselves in creativity, they are said symbolically to be synchronicious, arising in creativity at the very moment of inception. No arising or non-arising can be said to occur, no time or space. So creativity is a mere symbol word designating nothing. Since nothing neither alters nor sublimates, how can it move an iota out of luminous mind? So all these dopesters thinking that they're really hip, getting high, you know, what they should be doing is they should read a chapter of this book. And people wonder, well, there's no problem with getting high all the time and dope. I'm not missing anything. Well, they're missing out on this, aren't they? Missing out on being able to read a chapter of the book like that and recognize what's being said and experience this clearly. They're missing out on that. A lot of older people now are into dope. They're getting it for medical purposes. There's all these pills and food. There's all these different ways that they ingest. I know I've heard quite a few elder people are now heavy users of dope, and they claim, you know, for medical purposes, oh, it's the only way, you know, they stay high all the time. Remember, the world is completely at our mercy, 100% at our mercy. Everything, including all sickness, is totally at our mercy. And we say, Holy Spirit, be merciful with it. Let's not get rid of the mirror. Let's just reflect something different in the mirror. Okay, keep the mirror, that's fine. Keep the reflection. But let's reflect perfect wellness instead of sickness. There's a homeless man today. Looked like a nice man. I hate to see it. He's walking, you know. Anybody, please help me with a sign. And I said, ah, another homeless, wow. And he walks past me, and I look at him, I say, wow. You know? Let me reach in my wallet. So I pulled something out, but he'd walked down the line of cars, and he wasn't looking. I was at his back, and I was waiting for the light to turn. I said, oh my gosh, he's not going to see me. Well, the light stayed red, and it stayed red, and it stayed red, and it stayed red. And I was holding the money out the window, hoping he'd turn around. He was way far away, and he finally turned around, and someone else gave him some money, but he didn't see mine. I honked the horn. Hey, finally he saw it. But then the light turned green. It's like, uh-oh. And he's running towards me. And the car ahead of me started to go. And I said, I'm not going until this man gets that money. And he ran up to me very nicely and got the money. God bless. He said, I said, you too, God bless. And then I went. And nobody honked their horn at me. It was like a second or two delay. It wasn't a long delay at all, okay? It was a very short delay. I mean, you see delays 10 times, 100 times worse now with everybody texting now. But, you know, let the man get his money here. Just because the light turns green doesn't mean I have to go. Yeah, let him get a hold of it. And he did. So I thought that was a pretty awesome experience, actually, showing we don't always have to do with what the bureaucracy tells us to do. The light turns green, so you must go do it. I said, well, you know what? Compassion says, let the man get some money here. You know, five cars, give him a couple dollars. He's got enough to go to a place and buy food that might last them 3 days or something. Get a nice hearty dinner somewhere, you know, really a big portion or something. Keep them going. Keep them going. He has something valuable to add to the world. We need to start being nicer to people. We may have just a short time left to do that, actually. We just better start waking up to this. If this asteroid hits, if an asteroid hits, we may not have much time to be nice to one another. So we better be nice now. This is what I'm starting to see. Be nice to people. You know, just because someone lost their job and the banks, you know, snatched up their house or whatever happened. And nobody should be out on the streets, actually. This is just an abomination here in this country. We have so many homes with spare rooms. People tell me all the time, oh, you know, we got, the children are gone, we got 4 spare bedrooms, you know, it's a lot of upkeep on the house, oh, maybe we should downsize. Well, guess what? Maybe you should take a homeless person into your house. Feed them and help clothe them, give them shelter. Got so much empty space in so many homes. It's crazy. My grandmother used to do that during the Depression. Her house was a halfway house for all these homeless people, homeless men especially. They had a meal there and a room there. They had a big house and a lot of rooms, and they allowed these men to stay there who had no job, nothing. And she treated him great. I always respected her for that. Now, you know, a lot of them have drinking problems. Well, they probably, you know, are putting themselves to the ringer, like we all do here in this world. And you know, the stress of imperilment, they're putting themselves through it so severely that they feel they can't handle it anymore. It's just too vicious for them. So again, who cares what they use the money for? At least you give them some dignity. Of, you know, in your eyes, they're equal to you. Spiritual, we're all spiritual equals here. Let's stop kidding ourselves. We're all spiritual equals. Nobody's higher and nobody's lesser in terms of our standing with God. The only difference we see in this world is a temporary one. That's the difference of continuity fear in various of all of us. Different. We have different intensities and severity of continuity fear, and therefore feel bound to this belief in necessity, self-delusion of this belief in necessity of changing what we are. Some have freed themselves from that. Some are on their way close to freeing themselves from it. Some are working on towards it. And some feel just hopeless. They feel they don't know what's wrong. They don't know what to attend to. So they drink. They take drugs. Okay, that's a habit. And once the Holy Spirit can straighten them out, sober them up, get them thinking right and saying, hey, I need to attend to this. There is a problem. It's a continuity fear problem. I can attend to this. And then they start getting their dignity back. It says, I do have some value because I can free myself ultimately from this only problem that there is. Those who don't try, they feel no value in their life. And they project that on others and say, oh, you're terrible. You have no value. You're an idiot. Because they're only projecting their own despair upon others in that way. Because they don't know what to attend to. Well, at least here we're attending to what needs to be attended to. We know it, so we feel valuable. I feel valuable. I feel valuable. The world is at my mercy. I'm the only authority here. Say this. I feel valuable. The world is completely at my mercy. I am the only authority there is. I am the uncompounded now. The uncompoundable now is the only authority there is. There is no other authority whatsoever. None. And I am that sole authority. I am that one authority. Jesus threw the money changers out of the temple. He got very upset with them. And now we're in a situation now. I'm becoming more and more aware of it. People are informing me more and more and more. If you don't have credit, you can't survive. And then someone said something very wise to me today. He says, you know why they're doing this? Is they get a cut percentage of every transaction that takes place. The banksters. And I said, wow, I hadn't thought of that. That's why they want to get rid of cash. They want to get rid of cash, believe me. This is their goal, and they'll do it. We're closing in on that. It's very difficult to transfer large amounts of cash now. You cannot do it. It's a crime. You get thrown in jail. I mean, it's my money. I put $100,000 in the bank. I say, I want to take it out. You can't do it. What is this? What is this? This is criminal. This is criminal. The banksters are criminal. There's no question about it. It's a criminal cartel. I like cash. Let's use cash. We don't need to give the banksters credit, a cut of the action. No, this is my money. I want to give it to somebody here. And there's all sorts of things. You can't give free stuff to people. There's a lot of rules now that people are telling me that other countries are changing too. Or you want to be generous to somebody, you can't really be generous to them. No, the government has to intrude, and the banksters have to intrude, and they have to monitor your every action and get their cut, you know? What a bunch of criminals. And then Jesus got very irate, apparently, at these banksters in the temple, who were the money changers, who were had this huge business going on, getting filthy rich on it, of changing money for everybody and then taking a cut of everything. And they were selling the burnt offer, the animals to the, that was part of it. But I think the money changers was this idea of currency, that you could only use the currency, I guess it was the Jewish currency, to buy the sacrificial animals or the currency of that area, whatever, to quote unquote atone for your sins. Put the sin on a dove and kill the dove. What is that? This Old Testament mumbo jumbo magical thinking. And so the people came from all around, and then they had to change their money into this particular money for to buy the animals to be sacrificed. And so there's this huge money changing business in the temple, and that this was, they're taking this cuts out of everything. And I guess Jesus said, hey, you're trying to let us know, this is what you need to be aware of a monetary system that you're forced to give a cut of every last thing to these people. So here we are. We're already here. And I also found out that using a debit card does not build up any credit whatsoever. Zero. And I just use a debit card. I don't use a credit card. I'm not getting any credit, building up any credit whatsoever. Now, if you don't have a credit activity, you can't rent, you can't buy, you can't do these things. They have a credit report. It's got to see activity on your credit card. You can't just have a credit card and don't use it. You have to have activity on it. It's like, and so you can't, I mean, how do you even exist? It's getting very soon. You won't even be able to exist on this planet if you don't use credit cards. Mark of the beast, isn't it? Can't buy or sell unless you have the mark of the beast. Now you have these chips in your debit cards, and it takes like about a minute to read this stupid thing. I mean, it was ridiculous. You can't swipe your card anymore. You got to put it in a special reader. What is it? What does it take a minute to read the chip for? I mean, credit cards, you just swipe it through. I had a transaction yesterday. It took about 5 seconds. Thing printed right up, done. And yet debit cards, they're having to spend 30 seconds, minute, long time. Why? Why is the question. Maybe they don't like debit cards. They don't get enough of a cut out of it, although I think they do take a cut out of every debit transaction now. So, as a Christian friend said today, we're at the end time. We're right there. Jesus is so near. Well, it's more near than he realized. He's already here. Jesus is already back. And people just don't want to believe it's possible because they don't want to believe. They haven't attended to what they needed to attend to. They say, I'm not ready yet. Well, guess what? Imperilment is on its way, and we needed to get ready. And the difficulty of the last 60 years have been so extraordinary that if we didn't realize, hey, something is, we really need to buckle down here and find out what we need to attend to. Well, I don't know what to say. It's gross negligence is what it is. And people make excuses. Well, I thought it was something else. I thought I needed blah, blah, blah. Well, come on. Who are they trying to kid? Who are they trying to kid? Themselves. So hopefully I can get back on a positive push here. I've had struggle for about a week, a long trip, very tired, coming back into this hellhole, this shark tank of Silicon Valley, Bay Area. All the troubles coming, oh boy. I mean, it's just like going back into hell, plain and simple. So the thing to do is just keep putting our lives, turn our lives over the Holy Spirit. Say, Holy Spirit, you be in charge of the pragmatic reflection of this body and circumstances. You be in charge of it. I don't need it because I know that perfection is not the result of any narrative whatsoever. So I'm just going to feel perfect, and you can have the body appear any way, which way you want and have it go here and go have it go there, whatever you want. I'm just going to abide in this perfect feeling that's not dependent or derivative in any which way. Now, you may be wondering, how in the world can I speak like this? Well, I paid attention. I attended to Jesus Christ in A Course in Miracles and Longchenpa in spaciousness. Paid attention. Attended to them. I attended to them. And other teachers, Ramana Maharshi, attended to what his presence and what he had to say. And Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma attended to what she had to say, her presence, etc. And so, etc., on and on and on and on. Attended to this. Attended to it. Gave my attention to it. Attending to something means to give our attention to it. So this is why I'm able to convey and speak the way I speak, is putting my attention on these, on this, on their expression. I pick it up and say, wow, this is worth paying attention to. Can be nice, start being nice to people, and those who still have the guts to say, hey, there's something that we need to attend to. Again, remember, keep in mind, Christianity is based on the faith that there's something very important we need to attend to, all important. It doesn't mean that Christians know exactly what it is. They don't. Most of them don't know it. But at least they say, I know there is something, and my failure to attend to it is not good at all. I'm going to suffer for that. My suffering will continue if I don't attend to this. And I'm trying to attend to it. And I'm asking God for help. This is a Christian. This is a religious person. And so we don't want to, we're not overly strict, you know, towards Christians at all here. Pointing out the deficiencies is they haven't really figured out, you know, or seen what it is they need to attend to yet. Well, it's difficult to see it. And they have to keep trying. We all have to keep trying. So we certainly are not condemning Christians here in any which way. Any which way. I do point out that, you know, it has become somewhat of a parody of trying to just attain some sort of sophisticated spirituality, fake sophisticated spirituality, and then say, well, I don't really have to attend to this thing. I'm good. I'm far enough along. That doesn't work, and they know it. They know it. There's a lot of great Christians throughout history who gave a great effort, and I'm totally appreciative of all the efforts that they've given, because it's helped everyone out. At least we have this sense, at least we have enough sense of, hey, there is something important, and that gave me the push, you know, to keep working at it, to work at it and do my best at it. And then this has resulted in recognizing what it is we have to pay, you know, what it is that we need to pay attention to and attend to. So we can recognize it. We can recognize it. But I tell you, it has not been easy. The baffling defenses, obscurity and fear and all this stuff just makes us just feel like, I don't know. I don't know. What could it be? What could it be? What could it be? We just don't have a clue, most of us. I do meet some young people that are very wise, actually. That's very surprising. Not all young people are zombies, lemmings, actually. Not at all. Sometimes you meet some are very, very aware, saying, yeah. Quite interesting. And they're just normal people. Just humble, normal people. Having a tough time in life, and you know, they don't seem to be anyone special or important or anything like that. But you can tell that they're aware of some inner workings of the mind and spirit and some depth. And they're also aware that this world could very well face impairment. A lot of young people are aware of this. They may be aware of it because they came in with the knowledge of it. They were told specifically, hey, help the world out, help us. Wake us up, you know. Spread the word. I've been trying to spread the word my entire life about this coming impairment. Nobody paid any attention, really. I say, oh, I got other stuff to attend to, you know. I got to make more money, buy a better car, do this, and that's understandable. But we do have the capacity to, if we really care about it, to function in this world and still attend to what really has to be attended to. We do have that capability. Now, we won't be able to slack, can't be slackers and do that, but who wants to be a slacker, actually? Who really wants to be a slacker? I tell you, being a slacker, that's no fun. That's no fun. Doesn't feel very good at all. Maybe it won't get cold anymore here. I hope not. If it does, I'll have to head south. I know that was Holy Spirit's life, not mine. I'm just going to rest in the feeling of perfection. World is completely at my mercy. Say that. The world is completely at my mercy. The world is completely at my mercy. No exception. Totally at my mercy. Meaning I don't have to let anything dictate to me how I feel. I can feel perfect right now. I can feel perfect right now. In fact, I do feel perfect right now. That's the only feeling there is. Perfection is the only feeling there is, actually. Nothing else is a feeling. Perfection is the only feeling there is. This smoothed out perfection. Call it bliss, call it joy, call it love, call it truth, call it whatever. It's this smoothed out sameness, perfection. Cannot be corrupted in any way. Jesus said, don't lay up your treasures here in this world where, you know, the rust and moth corrupt, eat and corrupt and despoil everything. Lay it up in the world where nothing is corrupted. There's no corruption possible. Lay it up in the kingdom where there's no corruption possible, which is reality. It's right here, right now. It's present right now. It doesn't need any, it's not based on any narrative. So why does it need time? Why does it need process, to believe in process? Why does it need time, space, belief in distancing, distance? Why does it need form? Belief in crystallization doesn't require any narrative. Nothing happening or not happening. Neither happenings nor non-happenings does it require. Hopefully I can speak up more. I know it's so difficult in this world now. So difficult. Like the man told me, nobody ever says Merry Christmas anymore at all. You go into the store, they want you to buy. That's the new God. But, well, Merry Christmas? No, Happy Holidays. What does Happy Holidays mean? What does that mean, actually? Happy Holidays. You can say that at any time of the year. Summertime. Hey, have Happy Holidays. Holidays, yes. Summertime, have Happy Holidays. Oh, Happy Holidays. It doesn't bring to mind anything profound in the slightest bit. Nobody says, only older people say Merry Christmas. Everybody else, Happy holidays. I look like, am I being nice and robotic? Oh, I must be cool then. And happy holidays. Wow. I've tried Merry Christmas, it just doesn't work. The clerks in stores have told they'll be fired if they say Merry Christmas. They'll offend somebody, really? Well, I'm very offended by them not saying Merry Christmas. So they offended me. Do they get fired for offending me? Well, why do they get fired for offending somebody else and not me? Is that fair? Is that fair? Is that equitable? It's not equitable at all. That's very biased. It's very discriminatory. They can't have it both ways. You think they can have it both ways? They're not. Again, if someone says, they say Merry Christmas and they offend a person, that person complains and they get fired because you can't offend a person. Offend a person like that, it's not fair. Well, they say Happy Holidays, they're offending me severely. So if I go and complain, will they get fired because of that? No. So it's discrimination. Severe discrimination against Christians is taking place right now. Perfect example. Happy Holidays. So, I'm offended. Actually, it's very offensive to say that. Who are you to take the Christ out of Christmas? Who are you to say there's nothing important to attend to? That's a very, very arrogant thing to say, that you have nothing important to attend to. Well, guess what? Arrogance is what we have to attend to and to get free of it. And if we don't, we will continue to be arrogantly believe that the whim we had of changing what we are is not a whim but a need. That's what arrogance is saying. It's not a whim, it's a need. And then we will continue to try to serve this need. And we'll suffer. We'll keep having these terrible nightmares of death and impermanence and sickness and despair and conflict and depression and fear, etc., etc., etc. Loneliness, alienation, split-mindedness, mental illness, you on and on and on. Drug addiction, addictions of every kind. We will continue with all of that. So how fair is that to say, hey, this is what you have to do. Happy holidays. Keep your arrogance. How fair is that to anybody? You should say, Merry Christmas. And remember, we have this terrible problem we need to attend to. It's called spiritual arrogance, spiritual pride. We need to attend to this. And Christmas is set aside to remind us how important it is. We should be praying and fasting and contemplating and sharing the good news that there is something. We do have this problem we can attend to, and it can be resolved. Jesus told us this can be resolved, it will be resolved, but you must attend to it. This is the good news, this is the gospel. Christmas time is a time to focus on the gospel, which is the good news, the good news we can resolve this terrible continuity problem that we have, which was derived from arrogance, and now we're stuck with this continuity fear, and we can evaporate it and get free of it. That's the gospel. So this part of the year is set aside, saying, well, reminding everyone this is important. What kind of society is that doesn't remind themselves of what's truly important? That just says, let's just keep trusting in arrogance. This is what the materialists are saying. Let's just keep trusting in arrogance. How fair is that to anyway? It's completely unfair. It's being vicious and hateful to everyone, actually. So they're saying we have to live in a vicious, hateful society, culture. Otherwise, we're the ones who are vicious and terrible. What kind of double crazy insanity logic is that? That we have to, unless we agree to live in a vicious and hateful culture, then we're vicious and hateful. That's illogical, to say the least. It's totally illogical. And yet this is what they're telling. This is our future. This is our destiny. This is our culture. We've got no choice. It's putting the wrong folks are in charge, to say the least, here. And they'll soon experience the bitterness of their arrogance. Unexamined arrogance, spiritual pride, unexamined. Repent, repent, repent. Jesus said, repent, 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 repent. John the Baptist, repent, repent, repent. Kingdom of heaven is at hand. Natural perfection is already the case. It's not based on any narrative at all. Only arrogance would suggest that it is. And then this arrogance leads to continuity fear, which is a familiarity problem, thinking that this has been a need to feel, to think of imperilment. We're so used to it, we're afraid of non-imperilment. We say, I wouldn't know what to do. I don't know. That wouldn't exist. This is a continuity fear, familiarity problem. something we must attend to, something we must attend to. And Christmas is a reminder we have this very severe problem we need to attend to. Let us set aside this time of the year to remind ourselves of that. Now we get this obscene, everywhere you go get this obscene Christmas music. Most of it is just hideous. It starts right after Thanksgiving, Black Friday. You go into every store, it's got all this Christmas music again. Ooh, baby, 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 chase me around the Christmas tree or something. You know, it's just, you know, it's just complete secular pop culture garbage. They might throw in a few things, but it's all popped up. It's all popped up. It's no longer sacred. It's not a sacred season at all. It's a profane season now. It is the height of profanity. Christmas has become the height of profanity. 1 month of severe profanity in the world. Interesting, the server ordered some food today, and the server was very profane, making crude, profane jokes. Very nice man, but he has this habit that he needs to break. But maybe he was just reminding me that this Christmas season has become completely profane. So I don't get mad at people, really. I just say thank you for reminding me of something. But I don't necessarily am going to indulge. You know, once they remind me, I don't want to subject myself to disparagement, unnecessary, unjustified disparagement. No, it's ridiculous. It's like telling a virtuoso, you don't know how to play the piano at all. You don't have a clue. Well, guess what? I do have a clue. And so if you're really, truly a virtuoso playing the piano, somebody tells you you have no idea, you know that they have no idea, plain and simple. They have no idea. They're clueless at this point. Continuity, fear, cluelessness. That doesn't mean we can't get better at playing the piano. Absolutely, of course we can. Virtuoso, virtuoso, because they keep practicing, keep trying to get better. They're always trying to get better. But keep in mind, here, it's a little different. That metaphor breaks down, ultimately, because natural perfection is not based on any narrative whatsoever. Once we realize natural perfection, we realize there isn't any way to augment it at all, or get better at it. We can become more steady in abidance. Yes, we can do that. So that we can still give this somewhat semblance of progress that we're abiding more and more and more and more and more fully in natural perfection, the natural state. So don't watch the news. Don't watch it. Boycott the news. Boycott it. Be a boycotter. Be an activist here at this time. Be nice to everybody. Boycott the news. Boycott Christmas. Start boycotting these bad habits, this profanity in the world. Start boycotting the profanity in the world. The world is entirely at my mercy. Natural perfection is not based on any narrative whatsoever. I don't need a narrative. Okay? I don't need a good narrative. I don't need a bad narrative. I don't need a light narrative. I don't need a dark narrative. I don't need any narrative. Natural perfection already is the case. It's not sustained by a narrative at all either. It's not sustained, it's not augmented, it's not diminished. And our friend, our highly esteemed friend, Longchenpa, is relentlessly pointing this out to us in his work, Spaciousness, Radical Dzogchen, the Vajra Heart. Something like that. The radical. Yeah, the radical is actually on the Vajra heart. The diamond heart. The Dzogchen, I think it means natural perfection. The radical natural perfection of the diamond heart of what? Pure spaciousness, uncompounded isness reality. Uncompoundable isness, uncompoundable reality. The natural Dzogchen, the natural the perfection of the radical Dzogchen of the Vajra heart, the radical natural perfection of the diamond-like, clear light heart of reality. I I don't know how these Tibetans got all this. It's quite extraordinary, really. But they did. It's a marvel. They had these great teachers that come there in Tibet, it's hard to fathom. How in the world did they become so brilliantly clear about all of this? Something to do with where they lived and the type of lifestyle they lived, and they were somehow took to sitting in meditation in caves and studying and the long cold winter and a lot of various factors. I don't know their history, the bond religion that they had, but somehow they took to like a duck takes to water, and they had these great teachers go there. So it's one of the great historic spiritual centers of the planet is Tibet, actually. And their secularity, humanistic secularity, feels that the has no value at all. Wipe it out, get rid of it. No value. As far as Longchenpa appearing, well, there's this teacher in the 17th century or 8th, I can't remember his name, Jigme Lingpa or something, who Longchenpa appeared to him several times, because he wanted Longchenpa to appear, and he went through this very intense 3-year cave-like meditation of devotion and supplication and asking, and Longchenpa did appear. And then Longchenpa told him, if anyone wants me to appear to them, you know, this is how you do it. If you really want me to appear, I will appear. I just found this out last night reading a book about this great Nyingma teacher, Dzogchen teacher that was a couple hundred years ago. So, I had this, again, experience on November 2nd. I was at the first, November 1st of 2013, where I felt the world was so much into imperilment, and we were so losing the narrative that natural perfection is based on no narrative whatsoever, that we were desperate need of help here. All hands on deck. And so I really made this tremendously intense plea for help. And the very next night, I had this dream of this man appeared in my dream walking across the water. And later on, I found out it was Longchenpa. So he does appear. He does appear. Longchenpa does appear. This is quite extraordinary. It's one of the only cases I've ever come across where a great teacher says, I will appear if you really ask me to. I will appear for you. It's like, wow. It is really quite extraordinary here. And again, I mean, I didn't make any sectarian plea at all. It was complete. I said, I make no restrictions upon anyone, no strings attached here. This is just a straight out plea for any help whatsoever. So whoever, you know, he showed up. He didn't say, oh, you're a Christian, or you're this, or you're that, oh, I can't show up, I'm a Tibetan Buddhist. No, nothing like that. He says, yeah, let's get the help going. Let's get it going here. So this is really quite extraordinary. Now, to Tibetan Buddhists, this wouldn't be any big surprise at all. They've had this marvelous spiritual culture where miracles are normal. All sorts of tremendous miracles have happened through there for so long. They take it all just in stride for granted. Of course, this is the way it is. But for the rest of us, we don't not quite used to it like that. But my whole life has been steeped in the great lore of spiritual, high spiritual tradition. So For me, it's just, I said, wow, this is very great, very cool, but it's not entirely unexpected. I'll just go with the flow here. And but it, how impoverished are we in this society, this culture, this modern world? We are so incredibly impoverished through this lack of this miraculous situations outside the confines of our very rigid definition of what we think can happen in this dream of compoundment, of dream of imperilment. And we think, no, you die, you're finished, you cannot appear to anybody again. We have so many strictures against anything helpful happening here in our culture, that virtually, like, we're straitjacket, nothing helpful can happen is our mantra here in this world right now. Nothing really helpful can happen. We forbid it, we forbid it, we forbid it. Well, I don't forbid it. In fact, I welcome it. I welcome it. I welcome it. Let all adventitious, helpful events and miracles take place right here, right now. Right here, right now. They don't need any narrative. They don't need any narrative whatsoever. We don't need any narrative. Just let it happen right now. As an expression, as a reflection of our natural perfection, let our natural reflection be reflected in this world and a world right now. And whichever way it wants to be reflected, let it happen right now. It doesn't need any narrative behind it. Let it just happen right now. So you can see I'm starting to get some of my punch back here, which is a good thing. It's a good thing. The more punchy I am, the better it is. Somebody tried to kick me while I was down, actually. Yeah, I was down a little bit, and someone showed up on the scene here and tried to kick me. And I kicked back. Kicked back. Said, you're banned for now, right? Don't come around and try to kick me when I'm down. But, you know, I looked at it a helpful way. It was helpful. It was helpful. Gave me, like, smelling salts. Like, whoa. I need to get back on my feet here. Come on. This is go time. We've got to be very punchy right now. Very affirmative. Very helpful. Very nice to one another. Hopefully I can keep that trend up. I see someone who's got a nice bumper sticker. Give them a honk and say thumbs up. You know, hey, thank you. Thank you for reminding me. I see a lot of things like Jesus loves you. Or Jesus say, I come across these all the time. Little things that just remind me. Say, wow. Yeah. Let's not forget about Jesus. No matter how much we've struggled throughout the ages to try to understand what is it we need to attend to, at least we've been trying. And if we don't try, how can we win? It's like, you won't have tomorrow if you give up today, so hold on just a little longer. Help is on the way. That's the central Christian message. You can't, if you give up today, you won't have tomorrow. So we keep trying, we keep trying, we keep trying. And this trying is bearing fruit with me now. It's really bearing fruit. But the fruit is you know, slow in coming. It's true. The tree seems to, the fruit seems to ripen slowly. But hopefully when it does ripen, it's delicious. Natural perfection should be quite delicious. So make a point. Thank people if they remind you of something important. Thank them. Say, hey, thanks. Thank you. I appreciate it so much. Just express your appreciation. And whatever, someone prepared some real good food for me, I say, hey, I really appreciate it. Just tell them, I really appreciate it. I really appreciate you. Start telling them that. This is a very helpful practice. Because again, we may not have much time to do this here in this world. Troubles may be on the horizon. And it's the foreshadowing of it is intense right now. I'd be a liar if I said it wasn't. So tell people how appreciative you are of every little reminder. Because little things mean a lot here, actually. Just this little sign, you're down the dump, you see some license plate that says, no Jesus, no peace. And you say, wow, that's right. Thank you for reminding me. I was getting forgetful. That I need to realize that Jesus, have faith that he's telling us true. There's something we need to attend to and resolve. And that God is love. And we don't have to earn the love. It's naturally given to all equally. This is a Jesus message, so thank you for that reminder. Thank everybody for all the reminders that they give to everybody. It's very, very helpful. Just someone wearing a cross is helpful. I see someone wearing a cross, I say, thank you for the reminder. It doesn't matter what their beliefs are. It's what we put into it is what we get out of it. So it reminds me of something maybe very profound, where for them, maybe it was not on the same level of profundity, but at least it reminds me. So thank you. Thank you. Every little bit helps here. Every little bit, every reminder helps, and every attempt to forget doesn't help. It's okay. It doesn't help. But where are these punchy people that are on point in this world? This is my question. I can't find them. So I have to be it myself. I have to do it myself. I have to be this way, because it's difficult to find these people. Who are on fire. Now keep in mind, we can remember the truth. Keep in mind that Gautama Buddha had forgotten the truth and was trying to find it, and went through this long search of mental states, and then physical austerities, severe austerities, and he was ready to give up and said, I can't find it. And then suddenly remember when he was young that he knew what it was, and he suddenly, oh my gosh, yeah, I just forgot, but now I remember, and that was it. Who's to say that we won't remember? As I'm lying there, sitting there in the vehicle, almost nodding off, I suddenly feel this natural perfection that's not coming from any narrative whatsoever. And I say, hey, this is it. So don't give up. Remember, Buddha was right on the brink of giving up. So I can't find it. I can't help anybody here. It's not possible. And ready to drop the body. Just before he dropped, he was ready to drop the body. He was right on the very, very edge of it. He remembered. So the story goes. Oh, yeah. My gosh, I remember when I was just a young boy, I knew the answer. But the world led me astray from this answer. Middle path is don't pursue narratives. Don't get over pursue the narratives. Natural affection is not based on any narrative whatsoever, but as we come to this realization, don't get off on a tangent of thinking, oh my gosh, this is it, oh my gosh, this is it. I've got to, take the middle path. Don't overindulge in positivity or negativity. Don't get caught up in the positive narrative, don't get caught up in the negative narrative. Try to stay with poise. Be poised, calm, not attached, detached from narratives. The news is just feeding us constant narratives, isn't it? Now, it feels like we can't live without some narratives. Well, I just use sports as a very silly, superficial narrative. Blah, blah, talk about blah, blah, yeah. It doesn't, then drop it. Doesn't really mean anything. Who cares, if somebody swings and misses, didn't hit the slider. Oh, didn't he miss the slider? Okay. it doesn't really mean anything whatsoever. It's just a silly little game. Whereas other stuff, the narrative grips us much stronger and pulls us into down. Don't watch football anymore. Don't follow that narrative at all. Basketball, very little. Just a little bit of the Warriors. Baseball, less and less. And hockey, no, I don't follow that narrative. So golf, a little bit of narrative of that. Less and less, though. And basically, less and less narrative, following less and less narrative. And then, natural perfection. It's not based on any narrative whatsoever. doesn't need narrative. We don't need narrative, actually. We're so convinced we need narrative. We think narrative is life. We think this narrative we're dreaming is life. It's not. It's a dream of narrative, believing that this dream of narrative will result in us changing what we are. Reality isn't some narrative. We can't really understand reality from the standpoint of narrative. We cannot. If you think, well, what kind of narrative is it? Is it like? It's not really like narrative. So there's no way for us to understand reality in terms of our imagination. It's not possible. Our imagination is involved with narrative. If everything we see, everything is perfect, then there's no narrative really taking place. The vision of the real world, there's no narrative really taking place. But we can see that the potentiality is still there, the mirror is still there. But if everything's flawless and perfect and no compoundment, no crystallization, where's the narrative? There isn't any, really. Nothing's happening. Nothing can happen to change it, to do anything about it. So how can there be a narrative? There really isn't. So some little thing in your life, you'll suddenly realize, hey, I'm not quite as bad off as I thought I was. Maybe I can rally. Maybe I stepped on the scale. I was about like 5 pounds, four to five pounds lighter than I thought I was going to be. How about that? I just was just astonished. I said, are you kidding me? Jumped off the scale. I said, I'll take that. I'm not going to reweigh myself. I'll take that. I said, hey, maybe. I was feeling so heavy and sluggish. I thought I'd gain a lot of weight, but it was just the intensity of this world, of this attempt to push narratives on all of us, as if how we feel is dependent on narratives, and we just have to pick the right narrative. This is a lie. This is our delusion. The realization is just not based on any narratives whatsoever. Perfection, the feeling of perfection. None whatsoever. Never has been, never will be. This is the truth we have to get to. This is non-dual truth. There's not narrative and feeling. There's just the feeling of perfection. That's it. I've noticed a lot of slacking off and vanishment of a lot of non-dual teachers. You know, thank you all non-dual teachers. Thank you, thank you, thank you. You helped out a lot. You helped out a lot. A lot of them have just lack of interest. They just sort of gone into the background, as it were. And I don't know. But absolutely, they've been very helpful just by trying, by doing, by showing it's possible. You can speak up, you can speak up, you can speak up. Maybe they'll come back out of the shadows, I hope so. But there's very little response in the world now. Almost none. I seem to have the will to continue to speak up, even though, you know, very limited, wonderful response, but limited in terms of the amount of it. That's a good trait to have. Just no matter what, just continue, keep speaking, keep speaking up. People, the problem is that people think they're at the mercy of the world. And so in thinking so, they feel they can't follow along. They're not able to follow along. Well, no one's at the mercy of this world. No one's at the mercy of any world. No one's at the mercy of a body. No one's at the mercy of anybody. We're not at the mercy of the universe. We're not at the mercy of physics or chemistry or biology or any dynamics. We're not at the mercy of time, space, process, or form. We're not at the mercy of anything. That is a fact. We are not at the mercy of anything. Natural perfection is not at the mercy of anything. It's not at the mercy of any narrative whatsoever, not even a universal narrative, nor a non-universal narrative. It's neither at the mercy of a narrative nor no narrative. Neither one. Neither nor, neither nor, neither nor, neither nor, neither nor. We don't realize that we're going into a comatose state. The world is going into this comatose state. The signs are everywhere. People are sticking their heads in the sand. You know, sky is falling. Holy cow. Well, it may very well be the sky is falling, but that doesn't mean we stick our heads in the sand. We have options. We're not at the mercy of any asteroid. We're not at the mercy of any world. We're not at the mercy of any circumstance. We're not at the mercy of any situation. We are the sole authority that there is. We are the uncompoundable now. I am now. The uncompoundable I am now. The pure spaciousness, the Vajra heart. We are the sole authority. We are the only authority there is. Nothing else. There is no authority. So we're not at the mercy of any authority whatsoever. It's impossible. No other authority exists. I am the only authority there is. No other authority exists. Say that. I am the only authority there is. No other authority exists. I need to get some stick notes and say thanks for reminding me, thanks for the reminder. If I see some thinking of Jesus reminder or something or Longchamp or anything that's helpful reminder, just put a little sticker on that for them so they come out, you know, they see, oh, somebody said thanks for the reminder. I greatly appreciate the reminder. Something like that. Why don't we start doing something here? We're all like sitting on our hands. It's incredible. I mean, this is just a disgrace. It's such a disgrace. I don't know what to say. But I look at myself as a disgrace. I'm a disgrace in terms of positive activism. I'm doing what I can, but you know, it's like we're so circumscribed. It's like we're cattle. We got a cattle pen here. Oh, I hit the fence. Oh, I can't go any further. Maybe I can find some stickers somewhere. Say, appreciate the reminder. Order these rolls of stickers, and then just stick them everywhere that you see a reminder, just so they know, hey, somebody's paying attention to what you're saying, that you're helping. Thank you. And people will start saying, hey, maybe let's get ready for Jesus. He's already here. He's here as a friend, and he's going to, you know, who knows when he's going to make his presence felt more strongly. Could be right now. Maybe there's some stickers. Anyone knows any stickers online? Like, thank you for the reminder. Something like that. I've seen these. Actually, I saw a roll of stickers in a shop recently like that. A big roll of stickers. Some, you know, manufacturing company. Just peel off the sticker and stick it somewhere. I said, hey, yeah, I'm going to look online for that. Maybe, you know, see if I can do that. Start little acts of activism. Little acts of activism. Is justified right now. Little acts of kindness, random acts of kindness, random acts of activism in terms of thanks for the reminder. Little things go a long way here. Little things go a long way. Just a little help, like looking at that scale, popped me out of a negative trend, a feeling I had to give up. I said, no, I don't have to give up. Yeah. Sticker rolls. Yeah, I do it anonymously. I do a lot of stuff anonymously. You know, nobody has to take credit for it. Just do it. This is what the '60s. Just do it. Just be anonymous. Just be kind. Be do this, and you know the vibe built up from that. There was a vibe that built up. Let's go back before 1969, before we all fell asleep. The end of 1969, we all fell into a sleep. Let's go. Let's start reversing it now. I even got a hit. I got a hippie headband actually somewhere. I found one. I don't know where it is. Is it here? Let me see if I have it. I might. Let me see. No, I don't. I don't have it. What did I do with that? I don't know what I did with it. I don't. What? Oh, let me see. I'll find it. Yeah, I'll find it. You know, just say, hey, I'm gonna keep shining. I'm going to keep shining. I am going to keep shining. Everybody else is watching the news of all these shootings and shooters and blah blah blah, but I'm gonna shine. Let my natural perfection shine. Let the feeling of natural perfection shine into the world. Shine on the world. Shine on me. Love is the answer. Do something like that. Where are the shining people right now? The naturally shining people, truly natural shining, not because they're eating on a juice diet. That doesn't hurt, but it's not that kind of shining. Look at all the vitamins I'm taking. No, the natural shining of natural perfection. Shining of natural affection, shining of bliss. Where are those blissful ones? Well, we need them right now. We need them right now. See, you see the homeless? Give them some money. Give them some money. I don't have any money, but I have a couple of $1 bills in my wallet. Give them the money. Let them see you shine. They say, oh, there's someone that's shining. Oh, and maybe they may say, oh, they may suddenly be like the Buddha and say, oh my gosh, I just remembered I can shine too. I remember what shining's all about. I don't need a narrative to shine. What am I thinking? I've been under this spell here in this world. I thought I needed a narrative to shine. That's what falling asleep is all about, is thinking we need a narrative in order to shine, in order to feel our natural perfection. This is the delusion of this world. This is what the Elysian Fields, where you come and you fall asleep and dream or something like that. This is the dreamland here, of believing in false belief that we need these false needs, that we need a narrative. We don't need any narrative. Nobody needs any narrative. The homeless person doesn't need the narrative of being homeless. Next time I'll take him to a restaurant. I didn't have a place to put him. I said, hop in. Maybe I should make some room. I could make room, just pull over. I said, drive him to a restaurant and say, here, eat everything you want. I actually know the order that could last him a long time. Feed him for 3 days. Why not? Drive him to a restaurant. Treat him. I said, bill's on me. Bill's on me. I have so short time to be kind to people right now. God, put him up at a hotel or something. I mean, you have to, here's a couple nights. Stay here for a couple nights and get good warm shower, shampoo, nice bed, shave. Here's, you know, just start helping people out and be kind to people. Now, those are good works, so there's nothing wrong with good works. I never say there's anything wrong with good works. But these are good works done with the faith in Jesus Christ, in Longchenpa, in Rama Maharshi, Anandamayi, etc., Shankara, Buddha, etc., 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 of that we don't need any narrative at all. Natural perfection is not derived from any narrative whatsoever. There's no compound whatsoever. We're not bodies. We're free. We're still spirit, exactly as God created us to be. We are still that perfect being, that uncompoundable perfect being. And the world doesn't really exist at all, and yet we will have mercy upon it and let it remain as a reminder of non-imperilment. This needs to be at the center of our good works. So I'm not disagreeing with the Pope when the Pope says, let's do good works. That's a good message, except he's supposed to be the shepherd representing Jesus Christ. So he should tell them that faith is at the center of good works, not something, some orphan to be cast aside. And he's, in my opinion, he's leaned way too far that direction, which is a tendency of the Jesuits. They have that very strong tendency in that direction. And he certainly is an example of that. First Jesuit Pope ever. And it shows, it shows. But again, good works is a place for many to start. Let them start there. I have no opposition to that. Random acts of kindness. Do that, by all means, do that. If that's all you can do, by all means, do that. But let's not confuse that good works with the full gospel of Jesus. It's not. And this is the overemphasis is tending to divert our attention away from the fullness of his gospel, fullness of the good news. Our natural perfection is not based on any narrative whatsoever, nor is it sustained, nor is there any need to base it, nor sustain it on any narrative. God did not create any such need on us whatsoever. God did not create a need on us to change what we are. This is the fullness of the gospel, and we can have the death-free realm is there for us. The Holy Spirit is there for us. We can have this world reflect non-imperilment. This is the good, you know, the fullness of the gospel is there for us. This is what should be emphasized, the fullness of the gospel. But in our pragmatic day-to-day actions, let's not overlook good works. I probably need to do more good works. Somebody asked you, give them two thumbs up. This stuff's gratty. I feel great. I feel wonderful. I feel blessed. Really blessed. I feel really blessed. Oh yeah, I mean, me too. But I heard about the shooter today, or shooter. I said, what? I don't know anything about. I don't follow any meaningless narrative. Our being is not based on any narrative at all. So, I don't need to follow any of those narratives. You don't either. Nobody does. Be not diverted. Be not diverted from the gospel, the good news. Be not diverted from the good news. Thank people who remind you. Thank people who remind you. Thank those who remind you. Doesn't it just be some little sign somewhere that maybe someone put it there 10 years ago and just put a sticker, thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you. So little of that is happening right now. I miss the positive activism of the 60s. You know, it was a sight to behold. And I appreciated a lot of it. It was ragged, but people tried. You know, we tried. I didn't try enough. Because I'm more into theory, you know, the faith of it and the theory and getting to it. So I'm never been into a lot of works, but I certainly appreciated those who did so, and the attitude that they had. And they just do something kind to somebody. Doesn't matter, stranger. We're all both strangers and not strangers to one another. And just do a random act of kindness. I don't know. Two old ladies are trying to enter a store. One was in a wheelchair and the other was old, decrepit. And there's a push door and they're struggling. I can't do it. I saw it and I jumped up and ran over and said, here, took care of it, opened the door, and they looked at me just like kind of shocked. Oh, thank you so much, Wes. I really appreciate that. You know, they're struggling. They're struggling. Just notice stuff. Just be nice to people. Maybe they'll say, hey. Maybe they'll remember, like the Buddha remembered, and just say, oh, I remember now. I don't need a narrative to feel perfect. I just need a narrative to feel non-perfect. Why do I want to feel, do I have a need to feel non-perfect? No, it's a whim. It's a whim, not a need. Oh, yeah. I just remember, it's a whim, not a need. I remember that camel that gave me a calendar. The camel looked at me with his eyes and like the camel knew. It was like the camel knew. He said, I know what it's all about. He said, look, the camel, I've never seen a look like that before. I don't know. The camel's like looking at me like, I know you. I know what you're about. I'm not confused. Interesting. There's a little random act of kindness by the camel, right? The animals can do it too, why not? We tend to oversell the whole thing, yeah, but just here or there, little random acts of kindness, sure. Why not? Just take us up on the rest of the here, order what you want. And this is a place I know you order, just order and you pay right before you get it and you're done. So you say, here, order what you want. That's how much it is. Here, paid, done for. Relax here. Spend 3 hours eating your meal. Get a full meal. Take with you what you can't eat. And experience some dignity. It's outrageous the lack of dignity that these homeless people are going through. Yeah, it's just, I feel pathetic not doing something about it. We have a pathetic society in a lot of ways. So, let's do what we can. I don't know, trying to make a groundswell isn't really happening yet, but who knows how punchy someone can get and they may spark something. Maybe we just need this right spark plug, get the engine going. Maybe the engine cylinders are all there, it's just there's no spark. Not enough, put some gasoline in, get a spark going, and the engine starts going. It's possible. It is possible. It really is. I feel that people are still have, you know, they're just holding on to some, you know, faint, dim, like maybe. Maybe I can wake up from this dreadful sleep. I don't want to go into a deeper sleep. Maybe something can spark them. I don't know. By the way, this Bunya pine cone. Today I realized maybe what that's about. Shocked the heck out of me. Again, in researching it, I brought it around to everybody and showed them. So many people. And the number one response from almost everyone was, oh my God, what if that came down and hit you on the head? You'd be dead. You'd be dead. I said, what? And then I look at it, of course, this comes from the Bunya pine tree, which was around at the time of the dinosaurs. It's been around for so long. It's one of the few trees that's been around that long. And of course, the dinosaurs were wiped out by an asteroid. Something fell down on their heads and then killed them. And this is what the Bunya pine cone, everyone says, oh my gosh, what if that fell down from up there? And then someone in Golden Gate Park, it did. It fell down, hit them on the head, and almost killed them. This is one of these pine cones. Just after a while, just shortly after I got this pine cone, I found it. So again, this may be a reference to an asteroid. It absolutely may be a reference to it. Something coming in and hitting us so hard that, you know, just wipes us out. And this pine cone's so huge and so heavy, we never think anything. How would anything possibly fall down from a tree like that? We never even think of it. That's why everyone's so shocked. Oh my gosh, I never considered that this could fall down from a tree and hit me. How terrible. This is the reaction. So I was kind of disappointed in the reaction, but now I realize, you know, maybe they were telling me something, that this is, again, another sign. Let me see. It's still here, but it's all dried out. Another sign of what the universe is saying. Hey, I've got to look out for this. Boom. You know, you're going to get hit. It's still nice, isn't it? Yeah. So let's get this thing going of starting to be nice to people. How we can do this is, I don't know, maybe somebody will spark it. Maybe this is helping somebody, you know, helping spark it somehow. I'm not much of an activist or a works person, but some are like really great at that. Maybe the Pope is helping out with that. I hope so. I kind of doubt that it's exactly along those lines that we're talking about. But we'll take what we can get. I haven't felt that happening from Christians or Catholics. I have not felt it happening. It's still institutionalized to a large extent. We're talking about something a little more direct here. Catholic services feel as dead as ever, or more dead than ever. It's just they're going through the motions because of the teachings that have demoralized them. They're following a narrative. They think the narrative of Jesus is the answer. Now, Jesus came to say no narrative is the answer. You thought the narrative of my death is the answer? Well, God, no, it isn't. Here I am, and I'm leaving this place. No narrative is the answer. Not even the narrative of a wafer is the answer. There's no narrative is the answer. The answer is God created us perfect, created spirit as a spirit and truth, and we're perfect, and then that's how we feel. That is our feeling. We are perfect, so of course we feel perfect. There's no narrative involved in this whatsoever. What the Pope seems to be leaning toward is socialism, and that's not the answer. So there's a very heavy political, ideological, economic spin to what he's about, and we're not talking about that one way or the other. We're talking about something much more directly. Thank you for reminding me. There's something really important I need to attend to spiritually. This is the kind of activism we're talking about, not, hey, let's feed and clothe, let's have this equitable distribution, and you know, then we'll be happy, we'll have this utopia. That's not what we're talking about at all. Very likely, the imperilment is coming upon this world, and we need to be spiritually ready for that. So there's an urgency here, and we're not worried about what social economical system happens to be prevailing. We're deeper than that, way deeper than that. Well, we'll see what the Holy Spirit will fire up in our imagination. Maybe something, maybe some elephants will come to our attention. Some heavyweights that are all dressed up and adorned and walking through, and people say, wow. Elephant passing out flowers or something. I don't know. Maybe we should just start passing out flowers to everybody. That's what they did in the 60s. Flower children. The young people were just passed out flowers to everybody. It was awesome. Literally. Young people would get flowers from their houses, from their yards, from the countryside, wherever they could find them. They get flowers and have a big bunch of flowers, and they just go around, walk down on the streets of cities and towns and wherever, and they just pass out flowers. Here, have a flower. God bless her. Have a flower. All blessings to you in your life. You know, may grace, may your life be blessed with grace. Or however they want to express it. Just here's a flower. They just pass out free flowers. Pass out free flowers. Hey, that, you know, why not? Why not? The flower children wear flowers in their hair. That was, you know, that was sort of a back to nature thing. So it wasn't quite the religious spiritual thing that I'm trying to paint it as exactly. But if you could look at it with overtones or undertones of that, of, hey, you don't need a narrative to be beautiful. Have this flower. It's kind of like that. You don't need any narrative to be beautiful. You're beautiful. You're naturally beautiful. But hopefully they're trying to talk about the spirit and not the body. But you don't need any narrative. You don't need any money to be what you are. You don't need a narrative to be what you are. You're like this beautiful flower. You're beautiful. Your spirit is beautiful. The beautiful people, the flower children. They say, well, Jesus loves you just as you are. Well, we could really make it clear. Say, Jesus loves you because Jesus loves you because you don't need any narrative to be what you are whatsoever. So what's not to love? What's not to love? So maybe Jesus will start passing out flowers. Maybe you'll see Jesus on a corner passing out flowers. That's possible. Very possible. Very possible, actually. I think Jesus is going to be somebody sitting on some throne. Yeah, Jesus will probably be somebody in sandals on a corner passing out flowers. Everybody saying, you don't need to, I love you just the way you are. I mean, I love you because there's nothing not to love. What you are is not based on any narratives whatsoever. Have this flower. Have this beautiful flower. Maybe the flowers will be very beautiful. Possible. Maybe there'll just be this man, young man, walking along, passing out thousands and thousands and thousands of flowers and having these meetings with people as he passes them out. There's this brief moment. People start saying, hey, yeah, I kind of feel it's like this natural perfection. I feel like it's not based on anything. It's just, it's the root of my being. And all these narratives I've been dreaming hasn't touched it at all. Not in the slightest bit. And maybe we'll help Jesus pass out flowers. Start passing out flowers. Reminders or something like that. Why not? So, I braved the cold for 2 hours here. That's enough. That's why I like the summertime. It's always warm when I tape. It's always warm. Alright. Why not? Why not? Jesus loves us because what is there not to love? There's nothing there not to love, is there? It's easy. All right, very great. That's it for this one.